I'm a public artist here in Charlottesville, and some people might ask, what's a public artist? Well, a public artist can be an architect, it can be anybody. It can be somebody who has ideas and somebody who needs ideas to be implemented or put into some kind of context, and an architect does that. And we are here today, look at this place. I'm going to paint this here. Oh my goodness. What I do is I take my backpack, which is on my back. And it's on my back because it's easy to travel and hold my paints. These are my paints. And in my paints, also I have my canvases. Now these are, again, found wood in dumpster sites. And these canvases, basically what they do is they enable me to pack them on top of each other for use in a car. Smaller would be like the back of a motorcycle. And as you can see, I can throw them down. And I also put a special gesso, which is a cover, and it is applied because you need to have a gesso, and it protects your masonite from getting the paint absorbed, which I use acrylic. Acrylic is recyclable. You can put it on there if I don't like my painting, or if I want to use my palette, which I have over here. This is my palette. My palette is also recyclable. And it could be munched down and used as another palette or some other kind of top. It's a top to a container. So what I do is, oh my goodness, I find a spot. And this is spring. And so we are so delighted because in Virginia and in most of the country, there are these wonderful resources. We don't have to invent them. Nature gives us all kinds of colors, and the colors that nature gives us, we can learn from. Because as you can see in the water harmonizes the colors. In other words, if the sky is blue, you'll have blue in the water. If you have yellow from the sun, you'll have yellow as green in the trees. And on one side will be where the sun is hitting, and then on the other side will be the contrast, which would be the shade. And so if we look really close, which is what happens when you paint, you can find those, all those wonderful colors. There's 32 million colors, and I only have primary colors over here. And these primary colors are really dark red, ultramarine, and yellow, and blue. And so I'm gonna put these down here on my easel for a minute, and I'm going to grab a little water so my brushes are soft, and I'm going to grab another water over here, and I'm going to grab on my, I do need a little white, so I'm going to grab some white. Here's my white, and I need to have my brushes all ready. I usually use one brush, but I don't know what I'm going to do, so I grab my paint and I just squeeze it on. And I squeeze a lot of it on because I have big canvases. And this dries very quickly. And I'm going to have to go get that in the quarry probably. And I can know that I have to do this very quickly, because if I don't, it's gonna dry. And so that's why my paintings seem very lively, because these paintings that I do have to do with seeing and translating all the colors that I see. Oh, hey, look who's here.
Hey, Robin.
Hey, look who's here, everybody.
Good
Introduce
to see
yourself.
You. Yeah, hi. Welcome.
Tell everybody what your name is.
I'm Fred Oesch, and this is my home and office.
And this is your office?
Yes.
Oh, my goodness. Now, did you make this? Did you create it?
Yes. Me and one other person, we built the whole thing ourselves, just two people. And one of the, I think, the exciting things about it is that it's about 80% all recycled materials. It's basically all glass, but these windows came from a bank building in downtown Charlottesville that they were replacing their glass, so I got them for little or nothing. The major beams are also recycled, it's an example of what you can do with reclaimed materials and in a sustainable way.
Okay, well, grab a brush.
Okay.
And you're going to help me. Now, what my goal is today is to, I also recycle.
Yes.
And so I try to make things, I'm also making things with my paintings. So they have two purposes. One is just to be wonderful to have as like an aesthetic. And then the other thing is sometimes they become functional.
Mm-hmm.
So my idea today is that if you use this as a table, once you made the frame,
right,
you can make table legs,
right,
and actually collapse them and put them as a painting,
nice,
so that they hang, and then when you need a table. So what I'd like to do is I'm going to get my brush wet. You might want to do the same.
Okay.
And here's a rag for you so you can dip off some of that thing.
Okay.
And I'm going to sort of do something. And I'm just going to play around a little bit. Now, you're an artist as well. An architect is an artist?
Yes.
And what does that mean? Like, what is it that you personally do, and how did you come upon being an architect?
Well, I started out in fine art many years ago, and then...
Okay, go ahead.
We're doing this together, okay?
Yes, that's right.
Okay. And then one thing kind of led to another. I started working with furniture,
mm-hmm,
as furniture design,
mm-hmm,
and building and cabinetry.
Mm-hmm.
And then that led me, as kind of a nice evolution into doing architecture.
Mm.
And so the fusion that I see in terms of how art and architecture come into play is I like to think of my buildings as being habitable sculptures.
Mm.
So I try to approach what I do with that aesthetic in mind.
Now, you're doing amazing things in Charlottesville. What are you doing exactly?
Well, I'm involved in a number of different projects, one of which is eco community,
mm-hmm,
that involves some master site planning,
mm-hmm,
where we're really trying to keep the environment as it is, as
mm-hmm
natural as it can be,
mm-hmm,
and try to facilitate the interaction between people and the rest of the natural world.
So what have you done here exactly? What are the names of the places that you... First of all, you're here today because you're also contributing or donating. What are you donating to?
I'm actually the James River Green Building Council is one of my. Well, I'm actually on the board of directors of that organization. They're a really nice sort of advisory group and they work with all things in terms of sustainable design and building.
So what does that mean, sustainable?
Well, that is kind of a buzzword, but what I like to think of is a better word is maybe regenerative design, design that basically is self-maintaining, self-renewing, self-regenerating,
mm-hmm,
so that then that can include things like truly, literally organic systems like vegetated roofs,
mm-hmm,
using straw bale construction, and certainly things like post and beam, you know, using locally available recyclable renewable materials. Mm-hmm.
So in that respect, now first of all, you know, a lot of people believe, and I'm not sure why, that this planet is forever with all our resources. And you have decided that you're going to somehow not save the planet, but what are you really doing when you do sustainable?
You know, to me the bottom line is consciousness, raising consciousness and awareness in people as it relates to, again, kind of a harmonious interaction between people and the rest of the natural environment. Rather than being, you know, trying to overrule or to conquer nature, it's more of a matter of trying to work co-creatively and interactively with the natural elements.
Now, where do you get your inspiration? Do you get it from nature?
I do, very much so, which is one reason I have an all-glass office here is because this is such a nice environment. You know, during any time of the year, when it's raining, when it's snowing, even I call it my un-cubicle because it is kind of like a cubicle. I do work on a computer most of the day, every day, but at the same time, I don't feel alienated from the rest of the world. In fact, I feel very, you know, tuned into it.
So what are the names of some of the communities that you're interested in, for instance, that you've... And here's the thing, I mean... You talk about permaculture, and you talk about, what does that mean?
These are my koi, by the way.
Okay.
The
cool.
Letter.
Yeah.
Permaculture, yeah, that's, again, all these are kind of buzzwords, but the idea of permaculture is much like what I just described, where you're growing organic food in a very responsible way as it relates to the rest of the natural world. So for example, I'm currently designing a multi-purpose facility for Acorn Community.
What's that?
They are a spin-off of Twin Oaks near Richmond, and so they process and grow their own organic seeds, but they also wholesale and retail seeds. So this is a big building, about 5,000 square feet. It's going to be a hybrid, like straw bale, post and beam, solar, radiant floor heating, passive cooling. It's pretty much state of the art. And so that's one project I'm doing. And then another one here in Charlottesville is being done. It's 480 Rio Road, which is a hopeful 6 acre off of Rio Road development, which there again we're trying to do. It'll be more of a clustered housing kind of a project, but again, with water elements and sort of spaces where people like fire pits and different, you know, playscapes. And a community where a number of different people, not just one particular sort of stereotype, but young, old, every race, every income level, can live and interact with nature in a harmonious way.
So the idea for me, why I'm interested in you as an architect, I want to build something here in Charlottesville as well. And so what I do naturally is I look for something whereby I can, like this, sort of have a functional space.
Absolutely.
And so what you're talking about is like having farms or water fours and stuff like that. Can you explain that with a green roofing or whatever?
Yeah. I mean,
why is that important?
Well, for example, the project 480 Rio in Charlottesville, that particular project calls for clustered housing units that all have vegetated roof spaces.
Uh-huh.
So that...
What is that?
Well, they're called green roofs or vegetated roofs. They can be in a number of different types.
Uh-huh.
But it's so they can be extended outdoor living spaces. They can also be spaces where you can just go out and enjoy recreationally. They would be private. They would be rooftops, and each unit would have its own private rooftop.
Uh-huh.
And so you could have it as a separate garden space up there if you wanted to, or
uh-huh.
flowers, or just a living space. But in addition to that, as a greater part of the community, would also be communal garden spaces as well. So
everybody can grow their own food.
Yes, exactly.
Oh.
Exactly.
And why do we think that's important?
The cost of food is going up. There's so many processed foods these days.
What's a processed food?
Well, foods that, you know, have various chemicals or preservatives in them.
And do we have that in our supermarkets?
Absolutely. Probably most of what we have in our supermarkets is
because
exactly that way.
Is it
it's economical, I guess. It's,
no,
you know, big business.
Big business.
Yeah.
Tries to make them very quickly.
Exactly.
And organic foods or foods without pesticides and fertilizers and different chemicals have to be grown with the sun, right?
Exactly. And exactly. And another aspect of all these developments, too, is the notion of rainwater catchment, water recycling.
Why is that important?
Water is one of the most valuable resources that's being increasingly depleted on a worldwide basis today. I mean, there's certainly areas in the country that, you know, don't have the prolificity of water like we have here. So the idea of conserving water and of reusing it as much as possible, purifying it through natural means, biologically based means as compared to with chemicals, all of that is just going to lead to a more healthy environment for us all.
Well, I think this is a tabletop.
I think so. I think we have two of them. They're great.
Okay, so let's just take a look at this and see if they have anything to do with the environment, first of all.
I guess the question is, or maybe it's not a question, which is the right side up?
Uh-huh. But if it's a tabletop, you want to be able to...
From all sides.
Right,
that's right.
No,
exactly.
No, it's sort of an aerial view.
Right, absolutely.
So you have... Well, thank you so much for partaking now. The point of this exercise, so to speak, is that we are showing the innovation. That
yeah.
there is, when you build green, and you build from found wood, it lends itself to creativity, no?
Absolutely.
And can you tell us about that inspiration for yourself?
Yeah, I mean, I think another element of, well, using this building as an example, because I did build it with my own hands, and anyone who can be an owner builder, or even if all you do is paint, or whatever you do, your interaction with that building process, I think, you know, it's like a labor of love, and you have such an attachment to it, and a closeness, and emotional, you know, connection with it, that otherwise... You just don't quite have. So
what happens is, for instance, your history. If you don't mind, I'm gonna sort of let's walk around. I want to show a little bit about as we walk around how we sort of walk around your space. Here I see, for instance, these wonderful pieces of what?
Yes. This is soapstone. These are soapstone quarries. And this is scraps that I have accumulated from the area. This is also pieces of marble, which actually is not native to the area, but when the old operations were in process in this area, they brought it in. So these are marble scraps.
And these inspire me as well as you. You're a sculptor, you're an artist first, you've been doing this, what I would call playing. I mean, look at this. What is that?
Yes, that is going to be my cottage and art studio building. So what you see there is it's an oak tree. It's passed as it was cut off when it was a young tree, and they'd sprouted up with the many branches as we have there. This was actually a tree that was on a property about a half a mile from here So I actually cut it in one piece and brought it here on a big trailer and put it where it is now. So it is kind of the structural core for sort of an umbrella type structure that will be my cottage.
Cool.
That I'll be
and
living
it's
in.
That why I love you so much. Can we move a little bit over
oh,
here?
Sure, sure.
Is that I think what you inspire because of your brilliance in material use, it inspires, it's a natural form which nature is awesome. Nature has texture, it has color, it has even the leaves have form. And if you, as a nature person who studies nature and picks up these forms all the time, you are inspired as well about how to create something for human habitat that incorporates that feeling of being a part of nature. And this is so important today because we have been so, I hate to use the phrase, cookie-cutted, and we have so boxed everything so that we can mass produce it, that we don't stand and quietly just absorb all the beauty. And for you to take that time here, and where are we, and how did you decide to do this here?
Right. Years ago, when I was finishing grad school, I had this fantasy, kind of like Frank Lloyd Wright, Falling Water concept. I wanted to try to find a dramatic piece of property that I could do some kind of gymnastic sort of architecture with it. And in fact, I call this, as compared to Falling Water, I call it Rising Spring. And so I had been aware of the quarries here for a number of years because I used to come down here and get soapstone because it's such a perfect carving stone. You can use traditional woodworking equipment, and it's very easy to work, and it's resistant to acid rain if you have it outside. So it's really an ideal sculptural material.
So here we are, and you developed these sculptures, and what is sculpture really? I mean, the idea that, I guess that sculpture is a way of developing sort of natural forms or even forms that are not so natural into something that has a dimension, which is three dimensions. It's not something that is flat like a monitor or something like that. Sculpture is something that you can walk around and you can see all the views, and every view as you walk around, let's look at this for instance. You can see, for instance, this is one view, and then if you go around, it's another view. It's never boring. So sculpture is something like architecture in the sense that it's a three-dimensional dwelling that you want to aesthetically, and somebody like you, of course, because of your background, you're so rich and full of knowledge. And so when you do your architecture, you're looking at it in its entirety. And that's what's so great about you. Why I'm here today is to hopefully get more people to build from you. I mean, the idea that we can all live with such, depth and dimension, as it were, as a sculpture, you know, so that our dwelling, wherever we go in its entirety, can be something that is about us.
Right.
So you're going to build something for me, for instance, and it's going to be about me.
Yes, absolutely.
Not about going to Home or any of those places, box stores, and getting something that is already made just because it fits.
Right, right.
So you do the type of intimate reviewing, talking to people, and then you develop. Is that correct?
Yes, absolutely. There's some basic principles I think that constitutes good design or organic design. But then at the same time, it's more than just about form. It's also about your interaction and your involvement with that form. And I think that applies to architecture, it also applies to sculpture, it even applies to pretty much any of the fine arts, really. You know, it's about how you as an individual relate to this art, this piece of art. So it's an interactive process. What does it mean to you? What does it say to you? How does it make you feel? You know, and in the case of architecture, it directly impacts the quality of your life.
So how long, for instance, have you worked on a project, and like what size capacity or something like that? Can you give us an idea of something that was custom made for us by you?
I've been very fortunate to have been able to do many, many projects over the years, but they're all sort of one of a kind in the sense that they are all very responsive to what the individual wants. So, for example, I don't have a particular style that I work in. Even if the part of the objective is sustainability and solar and all the rest of that, you can incorporate those environmental principles and solar and all that into virtually any style. So it really comes down to a matter of what the individual wants, you know, what's going to please him and what they like.
Oh, so I understand that you also wrote a book.
Yeah, I'm in the process of completing it. It's called Your Affordable Green Home.
Oh, no. How did you come up with that?
Well, you know, particularly right now with the economy being such that it is, there's so many people out there that would like to do something, whether it's remodeling or upgrading or building an addition or even new construction. But, you know, it's a matter of, you know, finance right now. It's very difficult to do that kind of thing. So the idea of this book is really to kind of inform people and empower people in terms of, you know, what you can do even with limited resources. Mm. And even if you have more resources available, still how to, you know, value engineer and get the best bang for your buck. Mm. So Your Affordable Green Home is what it's about. And I cover all of those topics in terms of trying to help people to figure out how best to use their available resources.
Mm. And I'm so, right now, having such a good time.
Me too.
But, I mean, it's because of the way you put things together and that it makes me feel so alive. Like,
thank you.
Like the resources and the materials you use. They're alive. It's just a blessing to have you in Charlottesville.
Well, thank you.
And I'm so pleased that we can come here, and thank you so much for sharing your quarry.
You bet.
And I hope that in the future you can show us your progress and we can come visit again. It is just in March or now, but it's beautiful here, and some things are blooming or whatever, and I think that's a wrap.